We're back on the Chad Hasty Show, and the only problem with my guest coming on here is holding him back. He's one of these guys who has no brakes. He's just full throttles forward. His name is Marc Morano, and gosh, I don't even want to think about how long I've known Mark. I've worked with him in Washington, D.C. years and years and years ago, and he is a one-man doomsday machine against the climate changers, and began his career working for Rush Limbaugh. He's worked for Jim Inhofe, and I thought he also worked for that Pennsylvania senator, but worked in the Bush administration, and he's debated Bill Nye, been on all kinds of shows, CNN and so forth, just to name a few. And Mark also, a little while ago anyway, got the Accuracy and Media Award, called the Reed Irvine Award, and he got it alongside Andrew Breitbart. So that tells you how long he's been around. And Mark is one of the guys who first called out Al Gore and his ridiculousness. But on the phone, where are you today, Mark? Are you in D.C. or where are you?
I'm in outside of D.C. in Virginia.
Turning
rapidly blue.
All right. So you've spent your career calling out the climate change fraudsters, and I just gave everybody kind of a brief overview. But let's move fast forward. You were just in Madrid at the climate change conference. Set that up for us. Who was there? Who was sponsoring it? And what was it all about?
Well, every year, the United Nations hosts these climate summits, and I've been going to them since my first one was 2002, the UN Earth Summit in South Africa. And every year, this is they use enough emissions for African nations. Is that what African nations use an entire year? Private jets come in, they have all the world leaders, Hollywood celebrities. Typically, Leonardo DiCaprio comes and speaks. This year, he was replaced. Drum roll, please, by the Saint Greta, as she's now been dubbed.
Mm-hmm.
Greta Thunberg now has replaced both Al Gore and Leonardo DiCaprio. Al Gore showed up, but there was not much fuss about him being there at all. Everyone cared about Greta, and they surrounded her. Harrison Ford shows up. Bloomberg shows up. All the world leaders, except, of course, Donald Trump, show up. The head of the U.N. calls for global carbon taxes. The head of the U.N., Secretary General Gutierrez, is a former president of Socialist International. Surprise, surprise. So these conferences literally accomplished nothing. They agreed to meet next year and make more emission pledges. But the one thing they did agree on was to pass a climate gender justice resolution to have more meeting space for women and to include more women at future climate conferences. So at least they did have one big accomplishment.
There was some talk about during the conference, is the capitalist system capable of halting climate change? Talk a little bit about that.
Well, there were speakers. I interviewed David Suzuki, the famed Canadian environmentalist, who basically just says we have to have system overthrow, and that capitalism. And the other speakers and other people who have attended these included Naomi Klein, who's the author of the book "Capitalism Versus the Climate." In other words, capitalism is not compatible with a livable climate. So in order to save the planet, you have to A, accept that we're in a climate emergency, and B, turn over the keys to our economy, our development, industry, and even your home appliances, the way you travel, your home thermostat, et cetera, over to these international bureaucrats who will then centrally plan your life. How do we know this? This isn't some wild-eyed conspiracy theory. The former UN climate chief has said, quote, "We seek a centralized transformation that will make life on planet Earth very different for everyone," unquote. They talk openly of global governance. This is their goal. They have a slush fund. The only way you can get poor nations to sign on to emission-limiting treaties that will affect the development is to bribe the leaders. So you have guess who the largest delegations are? Developing world nations. Africa had the largest delegations of people sent to this conference. Why would that be? Africa is going to be the recipient of all this UN climate slush fund that they're going to get. It's essentially going to pay world leaders in poor nations. The poorer you keep your people, the less developed they are, the more earth-friendly, the more money you will get from the UN to ensure your reelection, to give out to your friends, to build monuments and stadiums, etc. This is the most – it's well thought out. I give the UN credit for that.
What's the general feeling there? I think I know the answer about Donald Trump.
Okay, I'll give you a good sense. In 2016, I went to the Moroccan UN Climate Summit. And this was 2 weeks after President Trump was elected, and the shock election that shocked the world and the media. I decided to have a little fun. Now, there were all kinds of people out there outside the media center. They had a little area, and they were doing all kinds of stunts, all left-wing environmental stunts. So I thought, right, no reason I can't do something. I got a life-size cutout of Donald Trump, and I got a paper shredder, and I got a copy of the UN Paris Agreement, and I started shredding. And I told reporters, or a couple of reporters met me there. They were interviewing me. I started shredding the document, and there was such a crowd and such a stir occurred, they immediately called UN police. So climate cops surrounded me. The entire place was, I'm talking like there was 100 people surrounding me. Police swarmed in. I was, and my partner, Craig Rucker, from CFAC, were literally figuratively removed from the conference. They pulled us, physically armed UN climate cops, and we were thrown out into the desert to wander the desert in Morocco outside of this conference center, which was out in the middle of nowhere. And then they had this, it was a big perimeter, and they tossed us out. And then they came back half hour later, confiscated my book bag, my briefcase, and all my papers. That gives you an idea of what they think of Donald Trump. Zero tolerance policy for Donald Trump. They condemn him as much as they can. They try to ignore him being there.
All right.
The perverse thing, Matt, is all these mayors and governors show up, and they start saying, we don't need the federal government. We're still in the UN agreement.
So a lot more to come. A lot more to come from Mark, and as always, he goes a million miles an hour, which is great. We're listening to Marc Morano, who is battling these climate nut cases, and we'll get more of Mark just after this. Welcome back to the Chad Hasty Show. I've got Marc Morano, who runs Climate Depot. You go on climatedepot.com and read more about what Mark's efforts have been over the years combating the climate change crazies. Hey, before we get to the top of the hour, and Mark's going to hold over the news, so he'll be back after 10 o'clock, but Mark, tell me about Al Gore. Does he look like the fat tick that he was a few years ago? I mean, has he just gotten worse?
But actually, no, I think he's actually slimmed down. He claims to be a vegan now, which is interesting. But he's still a little, he's not. I think he's lost some weight. He's got white hair now, but he doesn't have that star power even among the climate activists. Al Gore is the old guard. Now, just to give you an idea of how irrelevant Al Gore, he does this annual 24 hours of climate reality. I mean, people have checked into this. There may not even be a few hundred people watching at any given time, something that used to be a big deal 8, 9 years ago, 10 years ago when he started this. And we have now the Washington Post declaring President Obama a conservative. And why are they doing that? Because when it comes to climate policy, Obama is conservative. Joe Biden is the old guard. Nancy Pelosi is a climate denier.
Hang in there with us. Hang in there with us. We can kiss Al Gore goodbye. We'll be back after the news with Marc Morano. You're listening to KFYO. Welcome back to the Chad Hasty Show. Happy New Year's Eve. On the line from Virginia is Marc Morano, who runs climatedepot.com and who's been debunking successfully the climate change mystics and hoaxers for about the past 15, 20 years, right, Mark? I mean, that's how long you've been doing this.
Yeah, I started my first late 90s on global warming. But actually, back then, if you recall, Matt, when we worked together, it was the Amazon. That was the big issue.
That's right.
The 80s and 90s, the disappearing Amazon. How many football fields a minute? The forest. Guess what? Even the New York Times, by 2008, admitted that the Amazon was nearly intact, and for every acre of rainforest cut, 50 were being regenerated as people left the jungles, which is politically incorrect. You're supposed to say the tropical rainforest.
Right.
But they left the jungles to go to the urban areas. So and now they have such reforestation. So that issue died, and guess what replaced it? The environmental left went all in on global warming. And oddly enough, it's the same. It's the same solutions no matter what environmental scare they're talking about. It's always we need central planning, get rid of capitalism and wealth-limiting treaties and sovereignty-threatening treaties as well. So always the same solution. They use different scares, but climate is the latest scare, which is the same solution, which is basically an attack on the capitalist West that we've been dealing with since Paul Ehrlich's overpopulation bomb in the 1960s.
I want to get to that, who's behind this nonsense, in a second, but talk for a little bit about the oil and gas industry. Of course, out here in West Texas, that's a huge job engine, and of course, we're producing much, much more oil now, and to the point where we're pretty much independent for oil consumption. But at the same time, the voices have been, you know, raised way high against the oil and gas industry from the climate changers.
Well, okay, a couple things. First of all, on the top of Climate Depot, I have an article, Shock Epic Fails, the Decade That Blew Up Energy Predictions, the USA Energy Boom. And keep in mind, President Obama, you know, likes to say, well, you know, this all happened under my watch. The fracking boom, natural gas boom, happened because it wasn't on federal land. It was state land. States like Pennsylvania led the way, which cut U.S. carbon dioxide emissions. Not that we need to do it, but hey, we're doing better than all the European signatories. We had the largest drop because of American innovation and technology. But a decade ago, the Energy Information Administration did a whole bunch of projections, every single one spectacularly wrong about American energy, whether you're talking peak energy, CO2 emissions, U.S. electricity generation, it's unbelievable how technology has advanced. And props to Texas. As of February of this past of 2019, Texas crude oil production was breaking 1970s records. So Texas has been booming. All the while this is happening, you know, people are going after oil and gas. I mean, we have now Joe Biden openly saying that he will sacrifice fossil fuel workers, oil and gas workers, oil workers in Texas for the sake of the green economy and the Green New Deal and to save us from, you know, the climate crisis. So even the most moderate of all the Democrats, and I consider Biden one of the most moderate, especially in terms of climate, is now openly saying goodbye jobs because we need the Green New Deal to save us from the climate crisis.
When you start talking about Biden being a moderate, yeah, that is pretty amazing. You know, we've got a professor out here at Texas Tech that I think Greta Thunberg could be her mini-me. Her name is Catherine Hayhoe. Have you heard of her?
Yes. In fact, Catherine Hayhoe, if you remember, Newt Gingrich had his dalliances with the climate movement. He went to debate John Kerry and ended up agreeing with him years ago. He's always been tough. He was going to have Catherine Hayhoe co-author a book. And I did a whole series of exposés on Catherine Hayhoe and all of her bad prediction, her ideological activism. Rush Limbaugh picked it up. It became a national opera, and Newt Gingrich then dropped her. Actually, my headline was, Gingrich gives Hayhoe the heave-ho from the book. And it turns out Catherine Hayhoe is with the Union of Concerned Scientists, which is about as far left as Greenpeace. And she portrays herself as this middle-of-the-road, dispassionate scientist, just speaking. She was tapped by the assessment by the Obama administration to do this national climate assessment, which came out during the Trump administration. You know, Catherine Hayhoe and her co-author, Don Wobbles, all from the Union of Concerned Scientists, partnering with Obama's chief UN Paris negotiator, Andrew Light, during the Trump administration. This was it was commissioned during Obama. It came out during Trump. And the media had the gall to say Trump's own scientists disagree with him. No, these were Obama holdover left-wing activists from Union of Concerned Scientists issuing a report that was predetermined because we knew what they were going to say. Catherine Hayhoe has a long, woeful history of scientific, particularly when it comes to Texas. She talks all about the weather in Texas. I have a post, and this is from just a few years ago. Someone did an analysis of her claims on Lubbock, Texas, how she claims that Lubbock, Texas, the weather is more extreme, and they go through and point by point show that she's cherry picking. She's picking the baseline of cool periods to show extreme warmth, when if you go back further, it shows natural cycles. She is someone who the media loves. She's not going anywhere, and she portrays herself as some kind of climate expert. If I'm not mistaken, she's not even in the science division. She had to go to the political science division because the university wasn't even that impressed with her scientific skills. This was a few years back when she came to the university, but I believe she's in the political science division. I believe she still is in the political science division at her university.
Changing the gears a little bit here, Mark, you alluded to this earlier, and that is who is pushing all this? Who have become? I mean, who are behind these amiable nitwits that run around the planet shouting about this stuff? Is, I mean, I'm just going to, you know, cut right to the meat of it, to the bone rather. Is it the Russians, do you think? Is it the Chinese looking to cripple our economy? Is it a combination of both of them? What do you think?
Well, yeah, there's been reports of, you know, Russian funding and Chinese funding of environmental groups. We had, funny, the Sting video a few years back had the Hollywood celebrities. They had a group, a conservative group, posing as Arab sheiks, essentially saying, you know, we need to shut down U.S. fracking because it's hurting our business. Will you help us? And you had people like Ed Begley Jr. and others actually agreeing to help, and Josh Fox, who did the film. But George Soros, a major player behind all of this, Tides Foundation, and the Rockefeller. I mean, a lot of the same groups that have always promoted this. But what's happened here is they've created, even people that you mentioned, Catherine Hayhoe, we were talking about, she created a movement. She is now under attack by the climate emergency. She's now considered not radical enough by this base. There's a whole climate emergency movement by Extinction Rebellion, the Greta school strike, Greta Thunberg, that now people like Nancy Pelosi and Dianne Feinstein are considered climate deniers because they don't want radical immediate action in declaring a climate emergency. So it's just amazing how this funding now has spawned this whole new generation, the Extinction Rebellion movement, which is the ones interrupting football games, disrupting traffic, shutting down Black Friday sales events, or doing anything they can to just disrupt daily life to scream climate emergency. And this is all – Greta is funded by wealthy, very wealthy, powerful people in Europe, and they started filming her from day one. She was never an accidental thing. This was a planned thing. To be an international phenomenon. And, of course, it's easy to succeed when you have every single media outlet, mainstream media outlet, willing to give her uncritical, you know, airtime hours a day whenever she needs it, speeches and UN platforms, et cetera.
Where do you see the climate changers going at this point? What are they going to open up new fronts? Or are they going to continue with the line they've taken? Or what direction in 2020 do you think they'll go?
Well, at Climate Depot today, Matt, the end of the decade, climate alarmism tipped into the climate emergency, the year of peak green BS. What they've done, they've just failed spectacularly for decade after decade. They can't get any traction since basically, you know, literally since the Amazon rainforest died by the early 2000s. Climate took over, and it really took over 2006 when Al Gore's film came out. That's when this lobbying started, and the Nobel Peace Prize, etc. So what they've done is they originally said, you know, snow is a thing of the past, and etc. Then we had record snow, I mean blizzards, and then they said, well, the snow you see outside is a product of global warming. Global warming can, you know, causes both more snow and less snow. And then they came up with opposite predictions. All that wasn't working. So now they've gone after the kids. And they've gone after the most shrill rhetoric they can come up with, the climate emergency, that you have countries, cities, universities, media organizations, all declaring a climate emergency and using that phrase now instead of global warming climate. So I can only see them getting more shrill. The key, though, 2020 is the year of a U.S. referendum on both the Green New Deal and the UN Paris Agreement, because it's a very clear choice. If President Trump wins re-election, Green New Deal is not going anywhere for the next 4 years, and the UN Paris Agreement, we officially exit, the U.S. does, climate pact. But if the Democrat wins, we're in. So I think that's going to be one of the big key fundamental issues of 2020. For the first time, the U.S. is actually going to have a referendum on what we think of climate change.
It's interesting you mentioned the Green New Deal, which kind of exploded in AOC's face, along with the jihad squad that she's a part of, and I think Pelosi kind of hushed him up. So you're saying there's a tension now between the Green New Dealers and the old guard Democrats.
Yeah, it's a huge tension. I mean, you have the protesters, the young kids protesting in Feinstein, Pelosi's office, doing sit-ins, not leaving, because they consider them the old stodgy guard, which, of course, Biden is part of. And you have the younger generation, people like Andrew Yang running for the Democrat nomination, are calling for the end of cars. And he envisions, this is his, you know, sort of dictatorial vision, that people are going to rent electric cars by the hour and only when needed, and that you won't need car ownership. They're deciding our future from a federal government point of view based on claims of a climate emergency. And that is frightening. I mean, they're actually thinking they're doing good. So I think what's going to happen is there's going to be a continued schism between, you know, the climate old guard, which includes sort of the Obama policies, versus the new radicalism of AOC. And I think the Democratic Party is clearly going toward AOC because that's where all the energy is, and that's where all the funding's going, and that's where all the kids are. So they're just very excited to toss Nancy and Joe Biden and all the other Democrats overboard to go with this radical new agenda. That's why I say 2020 will be the referendum on this.
I've gotten a real kick out of watching, for instance, Tom Steyer and mouth off on the campaign trail. He sounds like Bill McKibben a lot, that lunatic.
He does. It's funny because Tom Steyer, he's being replaced. I think Bloomberg is outdoing him, you know, with those money and just, you know, his presence. Steyer, just, I can't imagine going anywhere. Even the, you know, what's terrifying, what people don't realize, the reason the other Democrats and a lot of people don't want him running is because that means he's going to be spending his own money on himself. They don't want, they want him on the sidelines funding all of their stuff. And if he's in himself, his money's tied up. That was one of the biggest reasons climate activists and Democrat operatives didn't want him running, because they don't want his money tied up with himself, because they don't see him going anywhere. They see him wasting his own money when he could be giving it all to their causes.
Okay, in the few minutes we've got left, tell folks how they can access your information, your website, what you're able to do as far as speaking engagements, that type of thing, and of course how they can help with your actions and your research.
Okay, well, first of all, I'll do a little bragging here. The study, a journal Nature last July, did a ranking of hundreds of prominent climate skeptics and climate fear promoters. Of those, I was named the number one climate contrarian or climate skeptic in the media out of 386. So I had my book come out. I have a new edition, The Politically Incorrect Guide to Climate Change. Anyone in your audience who wants the A to Z on climate, if your kids are being indoctrinated, I have a whole chapter on that. I have a whole chapter on everything from the science to the politics, updated in 2019 to include a bonus chapter on the Green New Deal. You can also go on my film. I had a film come out in 2016, The Climate Hustle. The sequel, Climate Hustle 2, Rise of the Climate Monarchy, is going to be out in April of this year. 700 theaters. We've upped it from 400 last time. That's what we're projecting in U.S. and Canada. And it'll be, we'll have to announce the official date and everything. But those are the big events happening at Climate Depot. So if you go to Climate Depot, you can get a copy of the book, Politically Incorrect Guide to Climate Change, and get more information on the Climate Hustle 2, the sequel. And Kevin Sorbo, the actor, is the host of this film. And I'm the reporter in it. So
I'm glad to see you're not slowing down at all. And as I've told listeners earlier on, you've got one speed, and that's full speed ahead. You know, I want to just circle back. We just got a few minutes left to something that you talked about earlier, and it's a special interest of mine. You know, back in the 60s, and my God, we all don't want to live through some of that again, but we had the Soviets backing the Black Panthers. We had the Soviets backing the Weathermen. We had the Soviets backing the anti-war movement, which they didn't give two, you know, nits about the Black Panthers, the Weathermen, but anything to destroy the country from within was in their best interest. Are you convinced that the Soviets have a hand right now in the climate change movement?
Yeah, in fact, there's reports out, Washington Free Beacon from a few years ago, talking about the foreign firm funding U.S. green groups tied to state-owned Russian oil company. And part of this is, you know, in China and Russia love the idea of the U.S. hand. Let's go back to the U.N. Paris Agreement, which the U.S. agreed to in 2015. John Kerry signed on behalf of President Obama in 2016. The idea is all these other countries essentially made meaningless pledges. China, Russia, they didn't do anything that's going to hurt them. We actually made pledges that would harm us. So the idea of Russia and China liking the U.S. committing is deeply impossible. So essentially, remember, the U.N. conferences feature advocates calling for planned recessions in order to fight global warming. Now think about that. They like recessions because emissions go down, and allegedly that's better for the planet. And so they want us actually a government policy where we do degrowth the economy, a degrowth plan, and we do planned recessions. Well, what's a better planned recession than commitment to the UN Paris Agreement and or the Green New Deal? The Green New Deal's whole idea is a planned recession for the U.S. economy. That's what they're seeking. That's what they want. That's what Joe Biden's bragging about. He's willing to start cutting jobs in the energy sector based on fears of the climate. So, of course, Russia and China are going to be behind this. So it's very shadowy, and there's been lots of different conflicting reports over the years. I haven't been able to pin it down exactly, but there's definitely funding from both.
Oh, I think the information's there. I think they're sitting on it over in Langley. But Mark, thank you so much for being on the show today. It's great hearing your voice, and keep up the good work. And we'll get you back on the show down the road, and you can give us an update. This is Marc Morano. He's from Climate Depot, and you're listening to the Chad Hasty Show here on KFYO.